So we'll start with our unit 4. The topic is input output organization. The outline is, we have the topics input output interface, in which we do have the subtopics IO bus and interface modules. IO means input output, input output bus and interface modules, input output versus memory bus, IO bus versus memory bus, isolated versus memory mapped IO. So let me change the cursor here from regular cursor to, I want to pick for visibility, for like a laser pointer type. I think this is good. Akanksha, can you respond?
Yes, sir.
Is this good now, this pointer?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you mute you. Thank you. And then we come to this isolated versus memory mapped IO. So these are the topics that we'll be dealing with under IO interface. And then we do have asynchronous data transfer. How do we transfer the data? These are the methods. One is a stroke control method, and the other is a handshaking method. The other is an asynchronous serial transfer method. And thereafter, we proceed to modes of transfer. How do we transfer? What possibilities are there to transfer the data from IO devices to memory that is there inside the computer, and from memory inside the computer to outside the computer to the IO devices? How do we transfer? So there are mechanisms to transfer, and those mechanisms are programmed IO, interrupt initiated IO, direct memory access. These three methods we adopt to transfer the data from inside the computer to the outside world, that is to IO devices, and from IO devices to computer. And then we have the priority interrupt, in which we'll be dealing with daisy chaining and parallel priority interrupt, and then direct memory access, and then input output processor. So these are the topics that we are going to deal in this input output organization topic. So we have this input output devices, few input output devices been listed here. One is keyboard, and the behavior is input. Who is operating this? Human. Human is operating. Similarly, we have mouse, and the behavior is the input device, and human is operating. So likewise, we do have several devices, IO devices. All these are the IO devices, input and output. Few of them you can see here, output devices, such as voice output, sound output, laser printer, graphics display. The computer that the phone that you are using now is displaying something, some contents, the graphics display. So those are the output devices. And then coming to the modem. So this modem is actually transmitting data and also receiving. So that's the reason why the behavior is, it may be sometimes acting as an input, or sometimes it may be acting as an output device. Similarly, we have local area network, LAN. So such devices are there, input or output devices. So these are the devices. These devices, how we organize them, how we able to communicate, how we may establish communication between these devices to the computer. So that is the agenda. That is the details. Those details we are going to deal in this input output organization topic or unit. So in this IO interface, the very first listed here, IO interface. In this IO interface, these are the subtopics that we are going to deal with here. So let us have the introduction to this IO interface. Input output interface provides a method or a mechanism for transferring information between internal storage and external I/O devices. So here in this, we have some printer that is one I/O device, input-output device. We have a mouse. This is one device. We have a USB. We are plugging in USB pen drive. So that is one input-output device. So such several devices are there. So what is the mechanism or what is the method that we use to transfer information between internal storage? This internal storage is inside the computer. You have internal storage, and from that internal storage, because you see your CPU, that is central processing unit, it computes something. Suppose, say, for example, it is computing multiplication. So this multiplication, the result, that is the product, is stored in somewhere internal to the computer. So that product, that result, we must be able to see what it had computed. So unless you get not that result onto the something that is facilitating us to see, then there is no point of having a computer. So for that, we have to have these I/O devices, input-output devices. So we just cannot, if I have, suppose I have a monitor, without mechanism, I just cannot plug this monitor to some device that is the so-called computer. I cannot plug in just like that. There is a mechanism which is facilitating us to interface with the computer and be able to show the contents inside the computer to us. So that mechanism is I/O interface mechanism. So peripherals connected to a computer need special communication links for interfacing them with the central processing unit. These peripherals are nothing but these I/O devices. Peripherals connected to computer need special communication links. They need some sort of mechanism, this mechanism, special communication links mechanism for interfacing them, these peripherals, with the central processing unit. So that is the point here that we have to understand in this I/O interface introduction. So this, in this, why we need this special communication links. So the purpose of the communication link is to resolve the differences that exist between the central computer and each peripheral. So far, what all orally I have communicated, possibly you might not have, some may be finding it difficult to understand. So with these differences, you will appreciate. So first point is, peripherals, that is I/O devices, are electromechanical and electromagnetic devices. Electromechanical, your printer is a electromechanical. Part is the electronics in that, part is a mechanical. Your mouse is having some chip inside, that is electronics, and some wheels, something. Sorry, for a while, let me attend, your friend is calling me. Hello? Haan, walaikum salam, bolo, class mein hoon main, bolo. हाँ, तुम लोग लेट से ज्वाइन हुए शायद ना. अच्छा अच्छा ठीक है, मैं देखता हूँ अभी, एक मिनट. हेलो आकांक्षा, कैन यू रेस्पॉन्ड नाउ?
यस सर.
ओके Your friend, your classmate Asad has called me, so he's telling that unable to join the class. Let me check why they are unable to join.
Okay.
So then I will continue. So here I don't see anything that is coming to me. Like sometimes what happens if students are joining using the link, then I will be prompted here to admit or deny. So I am not seeing any some admit sort of thing. Sorry to interrupt you guys. I will just call back your friend Asad and I will intimate the same what. Okay, someone can mute themselves. Someone, if you are unmuted, please unmute. I will call your friend Asad. I will intimate the same.
Okay, sir.
I am really sorry, guys. Still, I am on the phone. COVID. They are warning on caller tune. So that is taking time to connect to us. Now connected. I don't know who is not responding now. Okay, anyway, I will continue with my presentation. I don't know why I am not seeing any admit or deny sort of prompt here. And your fellow friend also not responding. So he's calling now. Let me attend. Hello, Asad. One more time, can you try? Because I don't see any prompt here like admit or deny such a... Such a prompt I will see if you are trying. One more time, can you see, can you ensure your code, you have num-thvy. So guys, Asad is stating that he is unable to join. So I'm waiting for him. He's trying again. Sorry for the disturbance again. So let me see if prompt comes, then I can admit here. What happens is here I see two options here. One is admit, the other is deny. So I'm not seeing either of this. I don't know whether. I'm waiting for him. Okay. Still I'm waiting, guys. I'm sorry about that. I don't see anything coming here. Like you could prompt admin, admit. Or deny, these two things will come here. I have to pick one. So nothing is being prompted here. Again, he's calling. Hello, Asad. No, Baba. People have already joined. Your 32 members are there in the class now. Yeah, you do one thing. Are you joining from mobile phone or laptop? Whether have you been to that meet.google.com? What is that you see once going there? No, Baba, no such meeting. You first go to meet.google.com. Now what you see? Meet, okay. Now what you see? He's again trying. Sorry for the disturbance. Please bear with me. I'm extremely sorry. Your understand again his calling. Hello, Asad. Then you one more time you go to meet.google.com and this time from browser you try. I will forward the link to you. You please try that. Okay, they are trying. I'm sorry for that. I will continue my presentation. For today's sake, if they are unable to join, let us resolve this after class. Okay. Sorry, guys. I'm coming back to my discussion. Akanksha, can you respond? Can you see the presentation?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Okay, thank you. So. I was talking about why really we need communication link. So this communication link, I'm talking about this communication link that is the interface between our CPU and to the peripheral, the I/O devices. Like very quickly, let me go to this one here. This is your CPU and this is your I/O devices. All these are I/O devices. So we in between this, we have this interface. I'm talking about this communication link. This one I'm stating as a communication link. So he's again calling, disturbing. I don't know what's technically going wrong here. Let me attend and let me convey the same to him that today you don't join. Let us resolve the problem later on. So let me respond this to him. Hello. Okay. Today, because only half an hour left, you don't join. Let us resolve that problem later on, okay? Because already some 32 students are waiting for presentation. Hello, Asad. No issues with that, okay? Okay. So I'm back here. Akanksha, can you respond? Sorry for disturbing you. Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I was here actually this about communication link. So the problem here, why we need this communication link, why we need this this interface. So this interface is required because these are the problems that the peripherals, these I/O devices are electromechanical, as you see here. Some are magnetic disks. Some are magnetic tape, this is the printer, this is the keyboard, and the other is the display terminal. So these are, some are electromechanical and some are electromagnetic devices. So, and their manner of operation is different from the operation of the CPU and the memory. Because CPU and the memory, these are semiconductor devices. CPU is a central processing unit, which is purely semiconductor material. The material used is semiconductor material, and the memory that is RAM, your RAM and your ROM, random access memory, read-only memory, these are the memories. So these are again semiconductor materials. So and these devices here, partly electronics and partly mechanical. Here partly electronics and partly magnetic devices. So there is some sort of interface is required so that they can communicate each other. So that's the reason why this communication link is required. This is one issue that we have, why we need that. So the other is data transfer rate of peripherals is usually slower than transfer rate of the CPUs. Your CPU may be working with 2 gigahertz or CPUs may be working at 3 gigahertz, but your printer may not be able to take, the bits, the whatever the content that you have given to the printer to print. So the speed of that printer may not be operating at that high level, like a 2 gigahertz speed. It's a really huge speed. I mean, high speed it is. So this device, your keyboard may not be operating at that high speed the way processor is operating. So there should be a mechanism which synchronizes these two. So for that also we need this communication link. So the the data transfer rate of peripherals is usually slower than transfer rate of the CPU, and consequently the synchronization mechanism may be needed. So that is the second reason why we need this communication link. Now coming to the third reason why we need this, data codes and formats in peripherals differ from word format in the CPU and the memory. For example, inside the CPU, we may be storing, while you work with your arithmetic logic unit, in chunks of bits, in a hexa, like, 4 bits together, octal, 3 bits together. So in the chunks, so you may be sometimes storing your data inside the CPU. But while sending the data to the printer, you may not be sending in that chunks, like 4 bits. You may be sending 8 bits together. So there where the formats matters. So in order to handle such format differences between the devices, like CPU and the peripherals, so we need this communication links. And the fourth here is, the operating modes of peripherals are different from each other. For example, your mouse is working differently, your printer is working differently. There should not be any interference among the I/O devices that you have connected to the CPU. So without that mechanism, it is not going to work out if you simply plug in. Because after all, these devices are working with some current, some voltages. So your printer may be operating with some voltage, your mouse will be operating at a lower voltage than the printer. So if there is not any mechanism which is really not allowing them to interfere each other, then it will be difficult. So for that, we need to have this. The operating modes of peripherals are different from each other, and each must be controlled so as not to disturb the operation of other peripherals connected to the CPU. For that reason also, these communication links are required. So here, let me take that pointer again. So to resolve these differences, these are the problems that we have so far. 1, 2, 3, 4, these are the major differences that we have between the semiconductor devices, CPU, memory, and the peripheral devices, I/O devices. So now, what we do is, to resolve these differences, a special hardware component is required. So computer systems include special hardware components between the CPU and peripherals to supervise and synchronize all input and output transfers. So what is required here is a special hardware component is required. So this special hardware component is called interface units. These components are called interface units because they interface between the processor bus and the peripheral device. So this processor bus I have shown here earlier here, this processor is having actually a bus. We know what is bus because already in second unit we have seen common bus, why common bus is required. So this data and line, address line and control line, these are not single. Data line alone may have some 16 wires coming out here. Address line itself may have sometimes 8 wires or whatever, depending upon the complexity of the processor. So put together them, we are calling it as I/O input output bus. Why we are calling I/O bus? Because this the so-called bus is actually interfacing with this I/O devices, input output devices. That's why the name is I/O bus. Now, so these components are called interface units because they interface between processor bus and peripheral device. In addition, each device may have its own controller that supervises the operations of the particular mechanism in the peripheral. So apart from coordinating with all these four, these issues to apart from resolving these issues here, one, two, earlier we discussed, this device also may have, that is interface unit device, this is special hardware, also may have its own controller, which is again a hardware device, to supervise the operations of a particular mechanism in the peripheral. Now, coming to this, that is the introduction about the I/O interface. Now we are coming to this I/O bus and interface modules. This earlier was, that is I/O interface, why I/O interface is required. That was the discussion. Now, I/O bus and interface modules. Here, this is self-explanatory here. You see, there is a processor. Earlier, several times I had been to this figure. So each device is having its own interface. This is the key point. This is the important point to understand and to remember. Not that all I/Os are having a unique interface, and this unique interface is facilitating to interface with the processor. It's not like that. Every device, every I/O device, input output device, you can extend here your USB camera, your pen drive, and USB, anything that is there as other I/O devices. All these I/O devices, along with shown here, every I/O device will have its interface hardware. So this interface hardware, it's the job of the interface hardware to facilitate a mechanism which this processor and this I/O device can understand each other with the help of this hardware. How this interface is helping us, we'll see subsequent discussions, okay. This interface, hardware to connect I/O devices to bus. This is hardware, this interface, it's a hardware to connect I/O devices to the bus. This interface circuit, inside it will have address decoder. This interface, this device will have inside address decoder, control circuits, data registers, status registers. So we'll see them one after another in subsequent discussions here. The registers in I/O interface, this I/O interface, this hardware, this interface also will be having some registers. And those registers are buffer and control registers, some flags for status, some data to hold the data. Data is different and control is different. You know, we have seen in a common bus wherein we have read, write, load, and clear. All those are control signals. And the data is actually operand that we want to work with. So to store this data, we need some registers. And to store control bits, we need some registers. And flags, like if carry is generated or not, if overflow is occurring or not. For that, we need a status register. So we call flag in computer organization and architecture terminology. So this interface, basically what I'm trying to say here is, this interface will have all this. Some interface circuitry will be there. Inside the interface circuitry, address decoder will be there, control circuits will be available, data registers and state files. So coming to this, for a while I will stop here. What you can do is, if you have any doubts, you can unmute yourself and you can ask so far. Any doubts? Anyone having any doubts? You please unmute yourself. If no, then someone can respond. There is nothing like. Hello? Yeah, am I audible to everyone? Can someone respond?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah, others. Others. Okay, in the chat window they are typing. That's great. That's great. If you have any doubts, please unmute yourself and ask. If no doubts, I will proceed. Okay, I will proceed. I think no doubts. I will proceed. Okay, that's great. This IO bus consists of, as shown earlier, data lines, address lines, and control lines. Each peripheral device has associated with it an interface unit that is also already discussed. Each peripheral device, peripheral IO device, will have its own interface module. So that is also seen. Each interface decodes the address control received from the IO bus, interprets them for peripheral, provides signals for the peripheral controller. This is this interface, what it does, this is also seen here, it is having address decoder control circuits. So that's what again we're talking about. Here, for example, if you go here, this CPU suppose wants to communicate to the printer, for example. So let us say for understanding purpose, the address given to this keyboard is 1, and the address given to the printer is 2, and the address given to the magnetic disk is 3, and the address given to this magnetic tape is 4. And CPU wants to communicate to the printer. What is the address? Address is 2. So what happens is, this CPU will put on address lines address of this printer, that is 2. Now every interface is actually getting, see, every interface is connected here. So what happens is, this particular interface is so intelligently designed, it takes that 2, it understands that this is the address of the device that is being connected to it, and it gets activated itself because of this address given. And the other interfaces, they have address decoding mechanism inside. Since the address assigned to the keyboard is not 2, this interface address decoder intelligently so designed that it will not be getting activated. So meaning this interface, this interface, this interface will be disabled. Only this interface will be activated. At that time, then this printer and this processor, these two are in communication now. Okay, so that's how this, the whole concept is. The interface decodes the address first, and then it is also receiving some control signals from the IO bus, and this interface interprets them, what is the control received, to the peripheral and provides signals for the peripheral controller. Signals means data. So here, this control means here, if you go back here, control such as, for example, let me go back to the window, because somebody is trying to join, it seems. Here, I received some sound here. So I'm coming back to the presentation. Okay. So here the control means, this printer suppose not having a paper, okay, or out of ink. So such information, this interface, when it is trying to communicate to the printer, it sends along with the address, the CPU sends along with the address, control signals. These control signals are to check whether the printer is in condition or not. The condition, what would be the condition of the printer? Condition would be like a paper is there or not in the tray, whether the ink is there or not, sufficient ink is there or not, such. So this, to check such, it sends control signals. So this interface will check the printer status and will let know this processor back here that this is in condition or out of condition. So along with the address, this interface will also be receiving the control signals. Others also will be receiving the control signals. See, all interfaces are connected to the control line also. But since it is disabled and this has also been disabled, this has also been disabled, for them no matter what signal is coming here. Okay, so that is the thing here, this control. Once it is correct, I mean, this is in condition, then what is required is data signals will come here and it will print. If it is in condition, it will print. If it is not in condition, if paper is not there, this printer, inside this, there is a chip. This printer will respond to the interface that there is no paper. In turn, this control line will get a signal, and in turn it will be communicated to the processor that there is a problem in the printer, that paper is not there, something like that. So this provides signals, means this data signals. And it also synchronizes the data flow and supervises the transfer between the peripheral and processor. As I said earlier in I/O introduction, I/O interface introduction, this is working at 2 gigahertz or 3 gigahertz. With that speed, if it is sending the data, then this printer may not be working at that speed. So inside this interface, as I said, some registers, data registers will be there. What it does is, this printer, this interface, it will store inside the data registers all the contents that the processor is sending. According to the speed of this printer, this interface will send the data to the printer. At that speed, it may be taking this interface. Inside the data registers, it will be holding that data, because the speed is, there is a speed mismatch here between the processor and the printer. So now, that's what the synchronizes the data flow and supervises the transfer between peripheral and processor. Each peripheral has its own controller that operates the particular electromechanical device. This is also known to you people so far, because so many times we had been to this. Each peripheral is having its own. So now coming to this, the I/O bus from the processor is attached to all the peripheral interfaces, which we have seen. To communicate with a particular device, the processor places a device address on the address lines. This just now we have seen that to communicate with a particular device, processor places device address on the address lines. Each interface attached to the I/O bus contains an address decoder. This I said earlier here, this is having address decoder. This address decoder that monitors the address lines. When the interface detects its own address, this interface detects this device is detecting the address of this device. So when it is detecting, it activates the path between the bus lines and the device that it controls. All peripherals whose address doesn't correspond to the address in the bus are disabled by their interface. Okay, so I hope this is clear to you people. Now let us move on to another point here. At the same time, this address, with address itself here, address decoder. Now at the same time that the address is made available in the address lines, the processor provides a function code in the control. The interface selected responds to the function code and proceeds to execute it. So this function code I was talking about earlier here, along with the address, it also receives some control signals. These control signals we are calling technically, the terminology is function code. The function code is referred to as an I/O command. This function code, the control, actually is the control signal coming on the control lines or function code. And this function code is referred to as I/O command, input output command. In a sense, it is an instruction actually that is executed in the interface, and it is attached, and its attached peripheral unit. So this I/O command is actually an instruction. Is executed in the interface and its attached peripheral. The interpretation of the command depends on the peripheral that the processor is addressing. The interpretation meaning what's supposed to be this control command is. That depends very much upon the device that you are trying to connect with. Because here when you are trying to connect with the printer, then very obviously the what it has to do, this printer, relevant commands obviously you might be sending. But during magnetic disk, you may want to store some data into the magnetic disk, or you may want to read out some data from the magnetic disk. Reading and writing action related instructions you'll be sending. So that's what we mean here. The interpretation of the command depends on the peripheral means I/O device that the processor is accessing. So now, this command here, this function code, is also known as I/O command, is having four subcommands. There are four types of function commands. There are four types of function codes or I/O commands. The control command, status command, data output command, data input command. So let us see one by one what is the meaning of this. A control command is issued to activate the peripheral and to inform it what to do. This we have seen. All this we have seen actually. So very quickly I wrap this one. If you have any doubts, you can unmute yourself here at this stage. You can unmute and you can ask. So for example, a magnetic tape unit may be instructed to backspace the tape by one record, or to rewind the tape, or to start the tape moving in the forward direction. These may be the instructions that you may be, possible instructions that you may be giving to the magnetic tape. So this control command is issued to activate the peripheral and to inform it what to do. So what to do means what to do with the, what possible things we can do with magnetic tape. We can backspace the tape by one record, or to rewind the tape, or to start the tape moving in the forward direction. Such activities. So these instructions are there in the control command. The particular control command issue depends on the peripheral. This is very obvious again. And each peripheral receives its own distinguished sequence of control commands depending on its mode of operation. So now coming to the status command, this also we have seen earlier. I was telling about whether paper is there or not, such is used to test various status conditions in the interface and peripheral. For example, the computer may wish to check the status of the peripheral before a transfer is initiated. There is no point here if we directly send contents to the printer without checking whether ink is there or not, whether paper is fed properly or not. There is no point to directly send this data to the printer. So what is required is we have to test here. We have to test here before sending this data to the printer, whether printer itself is in condition or not, that we have to ensure. So that is what this status command is doing. So these errors, like if something is wrong with the I/O device, these errors are designated by setting bits in a status register that the processor can read at certain interval. Status setting bits means, suppose a paper is not there. There are two flip flops are there. One flip flop is the this side, MSB side. The other flip flop is LSB side. Paper not fed means this MSB should go one. Otherwise, it is zero. Paper not fed. If ink is not there, then LSB side flip flop should go high. Otherwise, it will be zero. So that is what setting bits means in the status register. So now coming to the data output command. If this is correct, then it can send the command to the interface that to execute. Let us see that in the data output command. So the data output command causes the interface to respond by transferring data from the bus into one of its registers. So here data output command, what it is doing is, it is sending, transferring data from the bus into one of its registers. Whose register? Here we have seen already here, this interface has got registers here. So this interface circuit also has got data registers, status registers. In the data, it will send for data output command, data registers. Consider an example with a tape unit. The computer starts the tape moving by issuing a control command. The processor then monitors the status of the tape by means of status command. When the tape is in the correct position, the processor issues a data output command. The interface responds to the address and command and transfers information from data lines, from data lines in the bus to its buffer register. The interface then communicates with the tape controller and sends the data to be stored on tape. Hope this is clear. If you have any doubts, you can unmute yourself at this stage. Data output command. Hope this is clear. Okay, I'll proceed to the last one here. With this, we will wrap the session. The data input command is the opposite of the data output command. So this data output command, it is coming, it is taking from the bus. Data is taken from the bus. If peripheral wants to send something to the processor, so at that time data input command. If peripheral wants to send something to the processor, then data input command. If processor wants to send something to the peripheral device, then it's the data output command. So if the data input command is the opposite of the data output command, in this case, the interface receives an item of data from the peripheral. So if you might have noted here, we are talking about data from the bus. From the bus, if you go here, from the bus, if it is coming, it's coming from the processor to the I/O device. If this keyboard wants to send data to the processor, then it is from the I/O device, or from the peripheral. So at that time, data input command. So data from the peripheral and places it in its buffer register. The processor checks if data are available by means of status command and then issues a data input. The interface places the data on the data lines where they are accepted by the. So at this stage, so I'm concluding my session with this. We'll see in the next session, this I/O bus versus memory bus. Anyone can please unmute yourself and can respond whether things are clear how the presentation was? Yeah, someone please unmute yourself.
It's clear, sir.
Okay, thank you. Someone other? Okay, thank you. Understandable. Okay, some are chatting. Okay, that's great. Okay, guys, what I will do is this presentation I will post onto the students' resources, and the relevant material also I'll be posting on the student resources. Unit wise material I will be possibly tonight for unit 4 related material, unit 4. Material I will be posting on student resources before 9 p.m. today. Okay. Thank you so much for attending the session. You can give your feedback, personal number on personal message also on WhatsApp. So if somewhere something wrong, if you people did not understand, so that also you can convey. Feel free to convey, because the true feedback is really helps to correct. So unnecessary boost is not required. So something is really wrong and not catching. So you please bring that one to my notice on my WhatsApp number. So please help so that we can run smoothly this online sessions. Thank you so much for attending. You can sign off now. Thank you so much. I'll be waiting in the class itself, but you people can sign up now. Okay, thank you, thank you. You can sign up now, no issues with that. So possibly you may be having some other class also now. So some other faculty may be waiting there. Thank you so much. Thank you guys, thank you. You can sign up now because some other faculty may be waiting there. Thank you so much. Thank you. So others can sign off here. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. You please join the other session. Some other faculty may be waiting for you. Thank you. Muhammad Riyaya, some other faculty may be waiting for you. Khalil, some may be waiting for you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much, guys. Khalil is still waiting. Thank you for attending, Khalil. Khalil, hello Khalil, can you respond? Okay, Khalil, I'm signing up now. Khalil, are you there? Hello Khalil, are you there? Can you unmute yourself? Hello Khalil? Khalil? Hello Khalil, are you there? Can you unmute yourself? Okay, I'm signing off anyway. Thank you for attending the session.